race. Woo-hoo! In case you don't know about Robin Brasley is the Angela Davis of Nassau County. She speaks nothing but truth to power.
Yes.
And I mean, she is a walking computer slash encyclopedia.
Yes.
She knows dates, times, places, and people from back when my mother was in the trenches.
Yes. Okay.
Robin Brasley is a consummate teacher and well-regarded servant leader, building capacities in multicultural communities. Robin has been in the trenches of our community since she was a young girl. For four generations, the Brasley women have been building communities and strengthening families. So now, it is my distinct pleasure to present to you our Truth to Power diva, the incomparable Robin S.
Brasley. My family, though, this is family. And we have come together on Malcolm X's birthday. And one of the things that I told my children, I said, you know, everybody, Malcolm was popular by the time we grew up and had children and all, and they made a movie and it was glamorous. And so all the kids were interested in Malcolm. And Malcolm, you know, the house Negro and the field Negro, that was a popular thing. And the militants all wanted to be in the field. Right, the Uncle Tom, so-called, the sellouts was in the house, and that was Malcolm's analogy. And I remember, and I'm explaining this to my children, and I said, but you know what? There was a third slave on that plantation, and they came out the house and the field, and you couldn't always tell who was who and what was what, but they wanted to be free, and they were the runaways. And that's what y'all gonna be. Y'all gonna be runaways. And I felt very proud that I had, you know, improved on Malcolm, which is what every generation is supposed to do,
improve on the legacy that they've left.
And so that's how I said I was on my way up here, and it was very difficult. And I said, okay, but I'm on my way to the Runaway Summit. Because I'm always to the folks that have come out the house and the field. From Massa to the overseer, because they came from everywhere. They was all colors. The Indians helped, the white people helped, and the black people sold out some time. It's the same microcosm that we have today.
That's right.
What's different now, though, is we've gotten locked in these categories of race and class and, most pathetically, party. And in Hempstead, it's never been about party.
Yes.
Those of us who grew up, when I grew up, the one thing that was very clear, if you wanted a job with CETA or Manpower or the Neighborhood Youth Corps, when you registered Republican.
That's right.
And we were raised saying, register Republican, but you can vote any way you want. But we also grew up with wise elders who told us, like Mr. Kears, who, and my Uncle Stanley Johnson, that was, you know, my Aunt Jackie Jackson, my Aunt Cynthia Cooper, we had very good training.
Yes.
And what they told us is you judge a person by their work, not their label.
That's right.
And I finally understand what Martin Luther King meant when he said, content of your character, not the color of your skin.
That's right.
But that took a lot of time of seeing if, as a people, we didn't always do right by each other. And I've watched the new generation of Hispanic brothers and sisters who are being sold out, and I always make a joke and be like the T.O. Tomasitos, you know, Uncle Tom's in Spanish, I'll be playing like I can say that. Right? Or the oppressor, you racist because you're white. But what happens when that activity is being done by people of the same race to each other? What do you call that?
Right.
So now my categories are very simple. You're either an oppressor and you're happy to be close to him, with him, under him, study from him and do his work, or you're a freedom fighter. Those are the two sides. You're struggling. You may not always get it right, but you're struggling for equal justice for all. You're struggling to assure that you don't economically or otherwise exploit someone because they're less powerful than you. And you certainly don't take advantage and lie to people that trust you so you can get them to work against their own interests.
Amen.
And we've been subject to
all of that.
That's right. True.
My belief was that when I ran for the school board in 1989, and I had a very good friend and neighbor, Stuart Richardson, some of you may know him, and he told me, because the backlash was so severe, and I'm thinking, because we grew up very idealistic. I see a lot of my classmates over there. We was idealistic. We were going to be prepared, work hard, and be ready for the opportunities that awaited us, and we were going to handle them with integrity and courage, and we were going to represent very well our community, our family, our race. That's what we grew up with. You know, the Black experience, you remember that?
Yes. Yes.
That's what we grew up with. And I thought when I came back and we were identifying these problems and we saw these solutions and we were very well educated, so we're going to get to work and make this sacrifice. And I wasn't prepared for the backlash. I didn't know where that came from. I didn't know you could be punished for standing up and doing what was right or for caring. This one man said to me, which is when I decided to run for the school board, and he said, well, Ms. Frazier, your daughter's in the good class. Why do you care about these other kids?
Wow.
In our schools, look like us, representing us. And I looked at him, I said, how dare you? You paid to be here every day, retired from New York City, which means you get two big checks. And if you feel like this about our kids, what the hell are you doing here? You should be ashamed of yourself. I talked about that man so bad, he almost started crying. He had to get away from me. And he didn't, the next year, he did not come back. Because we don't want those kinds of people.
Amen.
We want people who are moved by the injustice that they see.
Yes, that's right.
That's what I see in this ticket. That's why I came back. Tarina and I don't agree on politicians all the time, 100%.
That's right.
You know, and because I've seen a lot. And I've seen the people, Black, white, and Hispanic, who come and tell us that they're going to do the right thing. But I've also been elected, and I know how difficult it is. And I know what happens when a constituency talks and votes, what was that thing you said? And then they stay home until the next election or until you do something they don't like. So it's not just walk, talk, and vote, but it's get involved, learn something, and be a good citizen.
Yes.
If you get a good servant leader, you have to be a good citizen participant.
Yes.
And that means you label it and call it for yourself.
Yes.
No more paid operatives from outside coming in who can put on Facebook some pretty disgusting stuff about the people that live in this community, but they paid to come here. And when I saw that, I said, oh, you know what? That's why since 1989, and you can call me a lot of things, but sellout is not one of them.
All right.
And I've never, ever gotten anything that I didn't work hard first and more than deserved. I never cut a deal for nothing, and I never sold out a child or a family in this community. And you can take that to the bank. So when I see people that will sow seeds to create dissension and division, then they're not a leader, they're not politics, they're power hungry, they're greedy, and they're exploiting us. Because you don't get elected to the school board. A school board election, any election, is a race. It's a competition. And real leaders, when it's over, shake hands and we all get to work for the betterment of the community. Anytime anybody is trying to make you separate and hate and not work together and ignore the people, even if I don't like you, I have to listen to you. I have to represent you. That's what the Constitutional Oath of Office is about. So in addition to the work that's necessary, and I'm gonna tell you how significant it is, and I feel somewhat responsible, but I was younger then and didn't know. I learned a lot. When the party leader before Jay Jacobs, who remember who that was?
Sabbath.
Kind of fat guy.
Yes.
Right? And he was, you know, and he was just like Jay, which is so funny now. I had just come out, you know, this was coming of age, and they were talking to him, and everything that we said tonight that Supreme and others have said about him is what he was leading people saying about Sabbath.
That's correct.
And this has gone back, I guess,
almost 12 years?
No, more than 20. 20 or 30 years, because it was in the aftermath of the charter revision.
Right.
We were all part of that.
Right.
And we started getting sold out when they were drawing the lines, just so y'all would know. When the folks who was at the table negotiating the settlement had their eye on the seats that was gonna be created. That's why we only got 2 districts, not 3 like we should have had. Okay, but I'm just saying, that was just my opinion. So, and we still suffering from that, because right now, the election district is supposed to be 50 to 60,000 people. Which means Hempstead has more than enough to be its own district, and you take everybody else, so we could have 3 or 4 districts. Why are you concentrating, you know, all this percentage of people of the county's poor? Hempstead in the 3.8 miles, has 20% of the county's poor people in it. It's like, you know, so this is steering. These things don't happen by accident. This is, you know, political decisions and things like that. That's why it's important who your county executive is.
Amen.
And they're not gonna always be able to do everything you think they should. That's not what you elect them for. You elect them for judgment. You elect them for values, ethics. You trust, that's what they call it, representative government. You need to trust the people you elect to exercise their duties with integrity and ethics and a principle to restorative justice. Can't nobody come in and fix 500 years of institutional oppression and slavery and all. It's not gonna happen. And it's not gonna happen if we stay home and hope somebody else does it, or we only move when somebody that's paid from an outside organization tells us to get on their agenda like it's our own. We have to have our own agenda, and we have to have leadership that puts structures and resources and supports, and those are all human, not material, in place to help that happen. So you get asked to be on a committee, to be a representative, and you go, you're so proud. Did you read the policy or the rules that govern what you're coming to do? Did you ever look at the charter before you step up to serve? That's where the work comes in. No, so then you waiting for somebody to tell you what it is you're supposed to do and how you're supposed to do it, and then we don't need you representing us. We need people that can read it for themselves. Right? Whatever the rules is, that was the policy that Thurgood Marshall's mentor at Howard University. That was the rule. Read the book Simple Justice. He said, read it for yourself. Before you read any legal opinion, before you let anybody tell you, read it for yourself. And then have a discussion. And then read what somebody else interpreted. And then, so that's where we have to go, runaways. Right? Now we get a Harriet Tubman, we lucky. Somebody can lead the way. You know, but if it break down, everybody gotta run. You need to be able to think on your feet and get to going. You need to learn how to trust your instincts. You need to know when somebody is selling you out. And if you in the game, I just said, share this with Brother Benjamin. There's a difference in judgment and discernment. So you need to be at every table, because you don't know who the spook who sat by the door
is.
You might look like they selling out. They might really be getting some key information for the new passage on the Underground Railroad. You don't know. It's not on you to judge. It's on you to see who's doing what. That's what it is. It's on you to see. And that's how you're good citizens, because I was elected twice. And I even beat Betty Cross, and people go, oh God, nobody ever beat. And now they're trying to say we all on the same. Jim Garner had to make great appeals when I came back to Hempstead to get the dogs back and forth me. Because I was young, and I, you know, and that Mr. Kid Robin, there are no permanent friends, no permanent enemies in politics. And I was like, yeah, but I'm sorry, you selling me out. There was a Baldwin quote on my Facebook page, and it says, I'm with you, and I agree we can't have consensus unless what we agree, and your agreement is, you know, my oppression and dehumanization. I can't be down with that. I must have read that in English class at Hempstead High School when we had a curriculum with books like that on it. It took all that off. But I'm saying all that because it's something to judging, and then we get angry. And then even you can't have an ally who detests you. You can't be paid to come work with me, but when you get home, you're writing on Facebook that we morons, and excuse my you know, F-word stuff. I want to post it on Stand Up Hempstead. Yeah. So you bold with your ignorant coward racism. And what would allow you to think you could come into our community? Oh, I know. They said you could come. Yeah. And we gonna still sit and grin and talk to you. I'm not really good with all that. Okay, so I'm not really good with all that. But what I am good with is predicting things. And Hempstead, one of the things that I started out telling you about my friend Stuart, and Stuart said, one thing, Robin, about you guys, you'll scare them because the voting is so predictable in Long Island, in Nassau County, in Hempstead, that if you bring a small percentage more voters to the polls, you can change the course of any election.
Robin Braisley,
that's what we have to focus on. So if we want to change, and then let me just say the last thing I'm going to say, this whole thing about who just became a Democrat and who just became a Republican and all that, and I just have to laugh. That's how they said y'all didn't learn, that's how y'all lost when y'all called Don Ryan a racist. Mm-hmm. I agree. And then the from Hempstead was like, well, now that's just too much of a lie. But the truth is, one of the big problems with Jay is that he hasn't developed strong leadership, not just in the 18th Assembly District or the so-called corridor or in our neighborhoods, but in the entire county. Because a strong party will challenge you if you're not doing a good job. So it was more important. And that the Democrats face it. They're dealing with that nationally. How else could somebody like Al Sharpton come out against Marigold and he ain't called nobody we know? We all know him. You're going to speak out on the black community about an issue in our community and you didn't even give people you know the respect of a call? That's how you could tell when somebody is operating as a sellout in that instance. I'm not saying he's always a sellout, but in that instance, right? So that. But this is the thing. When Fannie Lou Hamer, because what we came up with many, many years ago, when we realized the Democratic Party wasn't representing us properly, we came up with the Fannie Lou Hamer Democratic Caucus. Tabernacle of One Accord Church, we was all in one of them meeting like this, and we should start our own. I had just read a Fannie Lou Hamer speech. I'm like, yes, we should. And it kind of took off. I know in retrospect it kind of took off because the Democrats had a plan and they needed us organized.
That's right.
Hez Brown ended up being the winner of the selection process that they had. I don't know any of those details. But the move was to take the party from Sabbath. And so they did that, right? They organized, they walked, they got the petitions, the very things we're talking about doing now. But the goal was to get Carolyn McCarthy elected to Congress. And guess what she was?
Republican.
Who had to change her party.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So this is not because you, and what we came up with then, which I believed it and I believe it today. When we go to vote, we vote for the character, the moral, ethical character, judgment of a person. It's not about a party. A party is a tool to get you to where you need to go. And the thing that we can say because of the choices that these gentlemen have made, Carl I've known longer than George, but in the time that we've known them, in the way we've come to know them, is that they do have the judgment and the character that we need to look at. We need, if we're going to work for, and we need to support by participating in the process. And that's what I came to say. To the runaway.